Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Saba, and today we are continuing our discussion of stock return distribution modeling and appropriate insights from mathematical statistics that can allow us to best fit our data to some theoretical distribution function. We have already covered that normal distributions are not necessarily the best solution that exists for some of the most well-known stock return distributions, such as the S&P 500. And in one of the most recent videos, we have investigated the hyperbolic second distribution and how it fits the data better, but not necessarily the best way possible. Today, we are discussing another theoretical distribution function that produces even heavier tails than the hypersecond distribution. That distribution is called the Laplace distribution, and it basically utilizes the logic of exponential functions to help us model return distribution. Without further ado, we have already got the spreadsheet with ranked daily returns of S&P 500 over here. And as usual, we have our normal cumulative distribution function over there already plotted over here. We just need to investigate what is the functional form of the Laplace distribution and try to fit the data using this. Well, Laplace distribution is not as easy to digest as the hypersecond distribution. Well, because there is a very intuitive logic, both in normal distribution and in the hypersecond distribution, that relates to the method of moments. Well, the method of moments basically states that you can estimate the parameters of the distribution function using several statistical moments of the empirical distribution. And if you match the statistical moment of the empirical distribution to those of a theoretical distribution, you can estimate the parameters of the function relatively well and generate a decent fit. However, this is not the best method possible for some of the distribution functions. So, for example, if you look at the Laplace distribution function, you see that it's basically two exponential functions glued together. We already know that the exponential distribution, the regular, the most commonly cited one, is only defined for non-negative values of x, and this regular exponential distribution is inapplicable to modeling stock returns, and that as they obviously can be both positive and negative. So we might want to have a distribution function that is defined over the whole real number line, so from minus infinity to plus infinity. And the Laplace distribution solves this problem in a very elegant way by just combining two exponential functions together. One for observations of x, so in our case, values of the return that are lower than or equal to some parameter mu, and the other bit for realizations of the stock return that are higher than this parameter mu. And you also get the scale parameter over here, the scale parameter b, which is, when you remember the distribution functions for the normal distribution and for the hypersecond distribution, well, this scale parameter seems quite analogous to the standard deviation, the sigma, for hypersecond and for the normal distribution. But let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. As for the Laplace distribution, the method of calibrating, of estimating the parameters mu and b, is different than that of a normal distribution. For the normal distribution, we could use the method of moment and come up with parameters mu and sigma that are equal to the average, so the mean, and the standard deviation. But for Laplace distribution, It is easier to get the best fit possible by using the maximum likelihood method. In that case, we need to estimate our mu as not the sample mean, but as the sample median, and we can estimate our b later on as the average absolute deviation of our returns, so our random variable realizations, from mu, so from the median. And we would have very well-defined relationships between the moment of the distribution, so mean, variance, skewness, and kurtosis, and other high moments, and those parameters. In case of the Laplace distribution, both the mean and the median, and actually the mode of the distribution as well, would be equal to mu. However, it's been proved for the Laplace distribution that the best estimation possible is to set our mu parameter to the sample median rather than the sample mean or the sample mode. So, without further ado, we can just apply the median function and get the median of our stock returns of S&P 500 and see that the median is slightly higher than the average. When the median is higher than the mean, we can already speculate that the distribution is negatively skewed. If the mean would be higher than the average, when we would talk about positive skewness, but that's not something we are too concerned with in that case, as obviously the Laplace distribution is totally symmetric. That's one of the features of it. And second, the differences between average and median are not that significant, so we can kind of forget about it for now. Then, to estimate the B parameter, we would need to figure out the average absolute deviation of the observations from the median. Well, as for the Laplace distribution, the variance is equal to 2b squared. We could theoretically just use the method of moments again and estimate b on turn as the square root of half of the variance. But again, it has been proven mathematically that the more precise, more efficient way of estimating B is using this maximum likelihood estimator. So to estimate B using the maximum likelihood estimator, let's just insert a column here and calculate the absolute deviations for each of our observations. So we need to calculate the absolute value of respective returns minus the sample median. And we'll just lock the row over here. Bottom right click it all the way down. And then calculate the average of those absolute deviations. And we see that the estimate of D is not exactly the same as the standard deviation that we might be tempted to use at the very start. Now, we are ready to actually plug those values into the function and figure out how good the fit would be for the Laplace distribution. Well, bearing in mind this function that we've written over here, we first need to figure out whether our return is higher or lower than the median. Given the formula, if the return is less than or equal to m, so our sample median, then we need to apply this formula at the top. So it's half times the exponent of our ranked return minus mu, so sample median, divided by our scale parameter b. And again, we lock the row over here. Then, if, on the other hand, our return, our observation, is higher than mu, higher than the sample median, we need to apply the other function that's written over here. So 1 minus 1/2 times the exponent off, minus, in that case, our ranked return, minus mu, so the sample median again, divided by the scale parameter b. And that's all there is. And now we can bottom right click this formula all the way down and see, even from the initial results that we get, that the Laplace distribution function produces a significantly better fit than the normal distribution here, as we can see that on the left tail, the Laplace function has a fatter tail than the normal distribution has. And even if we look at that graphically, we see that the fit is actually pretty decent. It's even when compared to microsecond distribution, the fit is remarkably better. Well, why is it the case? Well, exponential tails are heavier than the tails generated by the normal distribution, which in its essence has actually the double exponent, so the exponent of the square. Well, also, what happens here is that the excess kurtosis of the Laplace distribution is actually equal to 3 in comparison to the excess kurtosis of 0 for the normal distribution, obviously, and it's even higher than the excess kurtosis generated by the hypersecond distribution at 2. So if we consider what is actually the excess kurtosis of the empirical distribution of returns, so we need to apply the formula kurt for kurtosis for our actual returns, we can see that the kurtosis is higher than 3, it's actually almost 4, but obviously, as the kurtosis, the theoretical kurtosis of the Laplace distribution is closer to the actual empirical kurtosis of 3.83, then it's no surprise that the Laplace distribution generates an even better fit. So for the purposes of modeling the returns of S&P 500, it's a no-brainer that we should use Laplace over hyperbolic second, and we should use hyperbolic second over the normal distribution. That's not, by all means, the end of the story. Stay tuned, and in the next videos, we will investigate even more various distribution functions that can be extremely useful in modeling financial instrument returns. Leave a like under this video if you found it helpful. In the comments below, please post your suggestions on any other topics in economics and finance you would like to see future videos on. Don't forget to subscribe to our wonderful channel. Thank you very much, and goodbye.